علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا يا ربنا من فضلك علما وإخلاصا وحلما الحمد لله رب العالمين. We've reached chapter 12 in Riyad al-Salihin. Congratulations. Actually, it hasn't been that long. We've covered some decent territory. This chapter, باب الحث على الازدياد من الخير في أواخر العمر. The chapter of encouraging people to increase in good works, particularly at the end of their lives. It starts every chapter with one or a few verses of the Quran that he sees as being linked to the theme. He says here, قال تعالى أولم نعمركم ما يتذكر فيه من تذكر وجاءكم نذير. Has he not caused you to live a life long enough that someone who is thoughtful could think carefully about their lives, and the warner has come? Subhanallah. Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not caused you to live long enough that a person who is capable of reflection has a long enough time to reflect on how short life can be, or that the end is coming and a warner has come to you? The Sahaba said that the warner here is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Elsewhere, sometimes the nadir is the gray hair that comes. Right? That should be enough to warn us that we'd better start working on getting our act together. Has Allah not given you a long enough life? And what is a long enough life? Well, different things have been said. Some people have said have made it as extreme as reaching puberty is long enough to get it, right? But the general consensus amongst the Sahaba and the early Muslims is that it's 60 years of age. Because the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam that's going to come up that speaks about reaching 60 years of age. And we'll begin with the first hadith, inshallah. I can find it. Here we go. أما الأحاديث فالأول عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أعذر الله إلى امرئ أخر أجله حتى بلغ 60 سنة. Abu Hurairah relates that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam said that Allah has taken away the excuse of a person who he has allowed to live beyond 60 years of age. So according to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, after 60 there's no excuses left. Not that excuses work with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not that he was allowing people to have excuses, right? But it's a cause for reflection. Subhanallah. All of us benefit from a society and a community in which people have consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what this chapter is about. Realizing that life is short and we should increase in good works, particularly at the end of our lives, but that comes from a consciousness of our return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we see things going on in a society and people doing things to others or engaged in things that are just unhealthy, and we say, doesn't this person fear Allah? How does this person sleep at night? We want to be the person that can sleep at night, subhanAllah. And being a person who can sleep at night because they've done well by the others around them, and they want to live in a place where others do well by those around them, that's in everyone's best interest. That comes from increasing our consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. being thoughtful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which comes from our understanding who is Allah. What are the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What are the ways that He works in the world? His sunan, His ways of doing things. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is there making things happen in every moment of your life. For you to receive a lesson from that. For you to learn something from that. If you're attentive. Man alqa sama, man lahu qalbun wa alqa sama wa huwa shaheed. A person who has a heart and is listening and paying attention, right? And is a witness to what's going on around them, right? Here and present with their moment. We all benefit from a society where people have some consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah increase us in that. And of course, the intelligent believer is the one who knows that if Allah has allowed them to live to an advanced age, subhanAllah, all of the things that come with advanced age, wisdom, insight, life experience, subhanAllah, what a beautiful thing. What a beautiful thing. Let's celebrate it. Let's appreciate it. You only have one life to live, so live it in accordance with every moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you, as Allah is giving it to you. And we'll see in the second hadith from Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said that Umar radiallahu anhu used to bring me into his diwan, into his majlis, with the ashaykh of Badr, the older sahaba who fought at the Battle of Badr. And Ibn Abbas at this time was very, very young. فَكَأَنَّ بَعْضَهُمْ وَجَدَ فِي نَفْسِهِ. As if some of them found that that was inappropriate. We're the senior people and you're bringing this young man into our majlis where we're discussing affairs of state. That's kind of an insult to us. فَقَالَ لِمَا يَدْخُلُ هَذَا مَعْنَى وَلَنَا أَبْنَاءٌ مِثْلُهُ. Why do you bring him into our private meetings when we have children his age? And Umar said, radiallahu anhu, أَنَّهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ عَلِمْتُمْ. He's young, like you said, right? He's the age of your own children. فَدَعَانِي ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ. So he called me one day. He listened to what they're saying. They find it a little bit insulting that someone so young and one would assume in that youth, inexperienced, would be allowed to sit with them. It's inappropriate. So he called me one day and brought me in and he said, فَمَا رَأَيْتُ أَنَّهُ دَعَانِ يَوْمَ إِذٍ إِلَّا لِيُرِيَهُمْ. And I knew that he only brought me that day just to show them something, to teach them a lesson. And he said, مَا تَقُولُونَ فِي قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. What do you all say about the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتَحِ. When the victory of Allah comes and the opening, or when the help of Allah comes and the victory. فَقَالَ بَعْدُهُمْ. Some of them said, we've been commanded to نَحْمَدُ اللَّهَ, to praise Allah, and ask Him to forgive us. Now, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتَحِ. نعم ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا. نعم. Praise Allah. Ask Allah to forgive you. If He brings you that help and if He brings you that victory. وسكت بعضهم. And some of them didn't say anything. And he said to me, is that what you think, Ibn Abbas? And he said, no. He said, I said no. So what do you say then? He said, it is the end of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all of us, most of us are familiar with that hadith that Ibn Abbas said that إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتَحِ is the indication that the life of the Messenger, when it was revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in his lifetime, now they're in the Khilafah of Umar ibn al-Khattab, that was the indication of his death. And if we pay attention once more, we'll see exactly what Ibn Abbas saw. And of course he knows that also because he learned it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma faqqihhu fid-deen wa'allimhu at-ta'wil. Right? That's what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about him. Right? Allah, give him understanding, fiqh, in the deen, and teach him the explanation of the Qur'an. He said, it is the end of the life of the messenger that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him of. He said, if the help of Allah comes in the victory, and the messenger said to me, that is a sign that I will see happen among my people. Fasabbih, and when you see that sign, like Musa, when he was traveling with the young man, and he said, what happened to the fish? He said, oh, I forgot to tell you, the fish jumped away and jumped back into the water. And he said, that was the sign we were waiting for, and when we were supposed to do something, when Allah told me that sign was going to come, then I'd know that I needed to, right, get off the road here and find the person I'm going to learn from. Here also, the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam was told, when you see that great help of Allah, when you see that great opening, that victory, the great victory, then praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sabbihillah, right? Say subhanallah. Say alhamdulillah, and ask Allah to forgive you, because He relents to people and accepts their tawbah. And Umar radiallahu anhu said, I don't know anything other than about it than what you've just said right now. So Ibn Abbas proved that he knew and understood the Qur'an better even than senior Sahaba from around the people of Badr, from among the people of Badr. But of course our chapter is about doing good at the end of life. And here is the end of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in other narrations, the Sahaba said that at the end of his life, he would say, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa astaghfirullah, very, very frequently. And elsewhere, they will say that there was more and more revelation coming at the end of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So even the messenger, who all of his faults are forgiven that went before, and all of his faults will be forgiven that went after, he's still increasing and increasing in every moment, and he's our example, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The third hadith is from Aisha radiallahu anha. She said, مَا صَلَّى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ صَلَاةً بَعْدَ أَن نَزَلَتْ عَلَيْهِ إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتَحِ. The messenger never prayed a prayer after the revelation of when the help of Allah comes in his victory, except that he would say in it, سُبْحَانَكَ رَبَّنَا وَبِحَمْدِكَ اللَّهُمَّ اغْفِرْ لِي. This is مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. That he would say, glory to you, our Lord, in your perfection and your praise, and Allah forgive me. Some of the exegetes will say that he said it when he went down into ruku' after reciting this surah. And there are places in the Quran where there are sunnah phrases that the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam would stop and say when he would reach those verses. Isn't Allah the best of judges in Surah At-Din? And then we finish the surah and we say, before making ruku', bala. So is it that he said this in his ruku', or he would stop and say this before going into ruku', right? Both would be valid. وفي رواية صحيحين عنها كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يكثر أن يقول في ركوعه وسجوده. Right? That he would say that very frequently in his bowing and in his prostration. يتأول القرآن. Meaning that he would, يتأول القرآن here is he would act on what the Qur'an was telling him to do. كان القرآن يمشي. Right? There you go. Right? As we progress in life, we can become more like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? It's a beautiful thing. فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. Right? Becoming more like the Qur'an. acting on the Quran, following the way of the Messenger alayhi salat wa salam. No. But this is for the intelligent believer. This is for the believer that understands priorities. This is the believer who has embraced his life as a journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and understands the priorities, that if your destination and your objective is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will do your best to learn and act accordingly. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. وفي رواية لمسلم كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يكثر أن يقول قبل أن يموت سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أستغفرك وأتوب إليك سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أستغفرك وأتوب إليك سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. Aisha said, Ya Rasulullah, what are these new words that you're saying so often? And he said, that a sign was made for me among my ummah, that if I saw it, I should, the sign be either Ja'a Nasrullahi wa Fatah, if I saw it, right, I should do this. And it goes on, right, mentioning, right, a number of other instances in the same vein. The next hadith, number 4. An Anas رضي الله عنه إن الله عز وجل تابع الوحي على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبل وفاته حتى توفي أكثر ما كان الوحي عليه. The Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave so much consecutive revelation to the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam at the end of his life, that more revelation was coming at the end of his life than at any point earlier. Subhanallah. An increase in goodness, right? Because in the Quran is a great deal of goodness. So we see the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam increasing. Subhanallah. The warner comes. For many of us, the warner are the gray hairs that we have on our head. It's a beautiful thing. There's so much beauty in that. It's a sign of wisdom. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the white hair and the gray hair that comes is a light. A light of what? A light of experience. A light of understanding. A light of settledness. A light of being at peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the one who embraces that warner of gray hair or white hair and acts in accordance, in harmony with what it means, by becoming more contented with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you think that Allah is not going to become more contented with that person? Subhanallah. And we're living in a society that doesn't celebrate age. No, doesn't celebrate age. It celebrates only youth and recognizes only youth and is only interested in the younger and the opinion of the younger. And we see that Sayyidina Umar is bringing the younger Ibn Abbas into the majlis. That seems to inspire us to follow the way that American society goes. But then we stop, we take a breath. We use that age and that experience that we have, and we see that the reason why they didn't want him there was because they saw only his age. And they compared him to their own children of the same age and said, this is not appropriate. But there was an exception about Ibn Abbas. It's not about age. It's not about how old is this person and how old is that person. Is this one too old? Is this one too young? Is this one young enough? Or is this one old enough? But it's about the individual and the experience that this individual has, the wisdom that this individual has. And some people will receive it at a very young age, and not everybody will be able to recognize it. Not everybody will be able to celebrate what more frequently comes with gray hair, comes with white hair. But because we live in a society that doesn't recognize the value of that, we have people dye the white hair, dye the gray hair. They don't want anyone to see it. We're going to have like men in the masjid who are way, way too old to have such brilliantly robust hair coloring, right? And something looks askew. Something doesn't look right. And what doesn't look right is the loss of priorities. The fact that if our brother would just let those gray hairs show, but he never embraced them in the first place, right? He wanted to hide them and, you know, Al-Busiri, he said that, had I known that I would not respect the warner of gray hair that would come to my head out of embarrassment for not being in harmony and embracing this, I would have dyed my hair. So maybe it's out of embarrassment, right? For not yet reaching the point where one is settled and at peace with their life. I was recently on the East Coast and a brother was mentioning to me, one of the young professionals was mentioning to me that we've learned that we're supposed to respect our elders in the community. And we're very ready to do that, but we've discovered that there seems to be a difference between elders and elderly. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send us some elders. Because with this age is supposed to come wisdom and insight. With a certain age, a person is naturally called Shaykh. And this is the organic meaning of the word. They understand the deen to the point where, in the absence of a scholar or a teacher, some of our elders could guide us in the deen if they would just listen or had listened and understood the deen. But if they go their entire lives not learning, not trying or attempting to gain harmony with the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger, which are a goodness and a salve or a balsam for our human condition, then when they get old, they're just old, and we will show respect for them. But we all need to take a deep breath and ensure that we're not just going through the motions and missing out on a real life in the actual world that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created and put us in, because we're hiding away in places where we go through the motions. We act like robots. We plug and play and cut and paste and wait around for the end to come to us, right? Hoping that there's no big tragedies or catastrophes, instead of trying the world, testing the world, learning about the world, and being in life with your deen. Instead of hiding our children from the world, let's teach them to be leaders in the world. Because you can't hide them from the world when they leave your home. You won't be able to hide them from the world when you send them away to college. We have to experience this world and live this life and be part of it with our deen. Not hide in closets and cabinets where it's easy to practice, where it's easy to be a good Muslim. Subhanallah. This is a test, and tests are not always easy. Age is a beautiful thing. When we cannot or do not have the ability to benefit from the experience, the life experience of elders, when we have the inability to celebrate that experience, all of us are at a loss. We're trying to raise kids and we don't know exactly what to do next because there is no knowledge that's being passed on by a society around us, by people who went before us. We're trying to reinvent wheels. We're trying to figure out how to build Islamic institutions because we've never met anyone that ever lived or experienced healthy Islamic institutions. We can't even make a wudu area correctly in this country because the people who build our masajid never make wudu in a masjid in the countries where they came from, right? Subhanallah. But I said I would be positive. Now, we all lose when we can't find the wisdom in our elders. And all we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send us elders and not just elderly. We'll take care of our elderly. We'll respect our elderly. But Allah send us some elders because we could use some wisdom and some guidance from someone who knows what they're doing. Subhanallah. We should think about that as we become older, that we benefit and learn and listen and grow and stay true, because this is the only shot you've got. Allah give us tawfiq in it. How are we for time? 7:30, mashallah. We can go into chapter 13, Babu Bayan Kathrati Turuq al-Khayr, mashallah. There's so many good things that you can do in this life and in this world. He begins chapter 13 by citing the verses of the Quran, وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِ عَلِيمٍ. Whatever you do of good, Allah knows. Even if people don't know what you did, even if people don't know your intention, I don't know if the handouts probably don't go to chapter 13 because I told the sister that we would probably just complete chapter 12 and not go any further. But alhamdulillah, we're moving along. Tayyip?
Yes.
So, alhamdulillah, we read along with chapter 12, and now we'll venture boldly and with confidence and courage into the wilderness of chapter 13. Blind, right? Not being able to see at night. Right? If you drive in the desert in the middle of the night with no headlights on, right? You probably do okay, right? Or when you were a teenager, right? You come up in the car behind your friend and they don't know it's you. In the middle of the night with the headlights on, you come up real, real close and you turn the headlights off, right? That usually unsettles people a great deal, right? So we'll venture into chapter 13. And inshallah, Imam Nawawi will light our way. وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. It's not lost. In the next verse, وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ يَعْلَمْهُ اللَّهُ. Right? The same thing. Allah knows it. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. Let's stop. He stops there. Because the chapter is explaining or the explication of how many pathways of goodness there are in life. And when he reads this verse from Surah Zalzala, he wants to draw our attention to just the first half. Because that's all we need. We don't need to complete it right now because that's not the theme. That's not the subject matter. Whoever works even in Adam's weight of good will see it. Right? At the end of life. On the day of judgment. It will be there because nothing is lost on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you made the best intention that you could muster, not a perfect intention, might have some holes in it, right? Might need to be stitched up over here, right? And it might need to be, you know, tucked under over there, but it was the best intention you could muster. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows your sincerity. And you acted on it, and you did something of goodness, and it didn't come off exactly the way you wanted it to come off with all the grace and, right, beauty. But you did it and you made that effort. It's not lost on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if that was in question, people would hesitate before doing good. And we only have this life to live. So let's live it to the fullest and let's be people of good. Subhanallah. من عمل صالحا فلنفسه. Allah says, whoever does a good action, it's for his own benefit. Right? We don't benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we benefit ourselves. But we like to see Allah radi. We like to see Allah content with us. It gives us contentment to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is content. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those He's content with. وَأَمَّا الْأَحَدِيثِ. Elsewhere there's the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in which He says that Allah does not let the effort of any man or woman be lost. He doesn't let it be lost. The smallest effort. People are doing what they can. Subhanallah, the ways of doing good. The first hadith is from Abi Dharr. He says, الإيمان بالله والجهاد في سبيله. He said, O Messenger of Allah, which action, which work is the best? And he said, faith in Allah. Having faith is an action. The Sahaba used to say to one another, Ta'ala nu'min sa'a. Come, let's believe for a moment. Maybe we'll sit down and make dhikr. We'll sit down and remind one another of the teachings of deen. We'll talk about those aspects of Islam that inspire us or encourage us. We'll celebrate that iman. And they saw it as a verb, as an action. He said, belief in Allah and jihad in the way of Allah. Not talking about jihad in our masajid is not working. But we need to talk about jihad. We need to talk about what jihad is and what jihad is not. This is important. We need to have a discussion at some point about how we can make sure that no young man or no young Muslim woman, no young Muslim man could ever mistakenly think that it's okay in the teachings of Rasulullah, of the Messenger of Allah, to hurt another human soul. Right? To hurt another soul. This is not okay. And it doesn't matter what that soul is. Right? All you need to know is human soul is not okay. We don't need to talk about exceptions. Any exception only takes place in a court of law appointed by the political authority of the region where you live in the earth and after due diligence to bring a case against a person and find them guilty. And then we still respect the soul of the child of Adam. If we are angry about something, if we feel small about some politics going on somewhere in the world, maybe something's wrong with my manhood because I feel like I have to take out some type of feelings that are all theoretical, really. Really theoretical. Because nobody bombed your house. Nobody put you out. Nobody hurt one of your family members. We hurt for those who suffer. And there are correct ways to go about helping those who suffer. There are ways that are in harmony and in alignment with the teachings of Allah and His Messenger to go about righting wrongs. And human society has become very sophisticated in the possibilities, but you have to be an intelligent person. And while young people are misunderstanding the deen and running around like a bunch of knuckleheads, there are non-Muslims doing a better job than most Muslims at righting wrongs and redressing grievances and stepping up to the plate. But they're sharp people. They are insightful people. They're people who worked in order to understand the world and how it works. and how to maintain their humanity. SubhanAllah, we need to have a discussion about how we can go about ensuring that no one misunderstands the teachings of the Deen of Islam. Because sometimes we allow people to come up with mistaken understandings and think that actions are okay that are not okay. How did that happen? That's what we need to ask ourselves. How did it happen that there can be young people that think that actions that are harmful and in conflict with the very teachings of the deen somehow can be done in the name of the deen? There are people, and some of them are elderly and still think that. There is no life experience. There's a lot of gray hairs, but it's elderly and it's not elder. How does that happen? Something must not be going right. So avoiding talking about it is not going to help. Avoiding talking about it is not going to help. One thing that we can do is we can stop dumbing down our entire Muslim discourse the world over. Stop trying to force every single discussion about the deen into something so simplistic, so shallow, so thin that it cannot hold up where the rubber meets the road. What's the condition of the khuf that you can make wudu over when you put on the foot gear, like the leather socks that you wear, and you can wipe over them, right, when you make your wudu? Well, one of the conditions is that you can walk around a campsite for 24 hours without it coming apart or getting a hole in it or ripping. That's the condition of a khuf that we wear on our feet. If our discourse on the deen of Islam cannot hold up in a campsite for 24 hours, right, then our discourse is probably no better than the khuf that people wear on their feet. It's not a discourse on a deen that is a deen of the Lord of the universe, that is supposed to be a malad, that is supposed to be a balsam, that is supposed to be a healing for the people of this world. Who is the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Every black person, every red person, and all that is in between. And this healing is supposed to come to them. That was the mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that is what we should be celebrating when we make salawat on the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam. Bringing this healing. La taghdab. Don't get angry. Meaning control yourself when you get angry. Laysa al-qawiyyu ash-shadeedu bis-sur'ah. Right? The strong person is not the one who can wrestle his opponent to the ground. The strong person is the one who, if their opponent wrestles them to the ground, they don't lose their temper and start showing unsportsmanlike conduct. Right? SubhanAllah. Allahumma razuqna self-control. SubhanAllah. Faith and jihad. And what is jihad? You're striving to make the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most high. Word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is already higher than high. So what's going on here? The word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala high in the hearts of people. La ikraha fi ad-deen. There's no coercion in deen. You can't force someone to believe. You can force someone into submission maybe. But faith does not enter into their heart. That's a special thing between that person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, you cannot force a child to respect the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can force them to keep the mushaf on the highest shelf in the house. You can force someone to not do anything to the Qur'an that would be disrespectful to the Qur'an. But having a high regard For the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hearts of people comes from something different. We saw a music video that was a nasty music video, right? As nasty as you want to be. And they had it was from a South American country. And they put the Quran in the background of the rap music and all of this. Maybe they just wanted to have some Eastern flavors or something like that. Okay, what's the usual reaction of the Muslims? Let's get excited. Let's get what is. Well, if we were in some countries, we know exactly where we'd be going. We'd be burning tires and tipping over cars and setting shops on fire and breaking glass and laughing the whole time. Right? That's not the right reaction. Right? Because if someone doesn't understand how to respect the Quran or what the Quran is, then if we come at them aggressively and violently, or the maqam of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even, we come at them in this way, will we leave them with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uppermost in their heart, in their regard? No. That's what we need to consider when we think about jihad. When we say that we're engaged in jihad, and there are all different types of jihad, don't get it twisted and don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But we engage in something we call jihad in a way that will make people disgusted. When Amir Abdul Qadir was winning against the French, rahmatullahi alayh, he comported himself in such a way that when they took him captive, they treated him with so much respect. They honored him in Paris. They honored him in France, and they told him, you can choose any country in the world to go to, but you just can't be in Algeria until this conflict is over. Subhanallah. Sheikh Mohammed al-Ashmar, one of the leaders of the jihad against the French in Syria, when the French finally broke and gave their independence, they kept diplomatic relations with Syria. And all of the leaders of the jihad, like Sheikh Mohammed al-Ashmar, Sheikh Hassan Habannaka al-Midani, they respected so much. The Germans are in love with Salah ad-Din Ayyubi. Damascus is full of relics made by the Germans to celebrate Salah ad-Din Ayyubi. Right? There's this massive statue in front of Salah ad-Din's citadel in the center of the city, right, of Salah ad-Din and his soldiers, and they're so fierce and on horseback and all of this. And who made that? And whose idea was that? Oh yeah, the Germans just insisted that we like set that up here. In the grave of Salah ad-Din Ayyubi, in the mausoleum where he's buried, rahmatullahi alayh, there's the grave he's buried in, and then there's another sarcophagus next to it that was made by Germans, by the German government, to honor Salah ad-Din Ayyubi. They didn't use it, but they put it there, because that's what, you know, they insisted that it be put there. It's nicer than the original one, right? Subhanallah. Do we leave people with a sense that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are highmost in their hearts? And let's take it a little bit further. Is it just the words of Allah, the print on the page, the word Quran, or the content, the meanings of the Quran are now highmost in people's hearts? This is the meaning of jihad, to make an effort to bring the content of the Quran. And what's the name of our chapter? 13. How many, right, ways of good are there in the Deen of Islam? How many ways in the Deen of Islam are there to do good things? The first hadith, faith in Allah and jihad fi sabilillah. And we discussed the meaning of jihad. And the things that I've said tonight about the meanings of jihad, you've heard many teachers explain the meanings of jihad in different ways. Good teachers. Huh? And I've explain some facets of that. So put that together with the good things that you already know. We say to strive and make effort to do what is good. That is the way we define jihad. To the point where, maybe some years ago, about 5, 6, 7 years ago or so, even the non-Muslims will say, you know, trying to quit smoking, really, it's my jihad, right? Anything that they saw as like a good thing, they would start saying, that's my jihad. Because people are getting a sense, right, of what that might be. And they get that sense from us, but we have to understand it first. The difference between being an elder and being elderly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let us grow into being elders and not just elderly. Subhanallah. Barakallahu feekum. We'll stop here, inshallah. Ahsanallahu ilaykum. Allah give you all tawfiq. Allah give you all peace. Allah give you all i'ana. Allah give you joy in your homes and with your families, wherever you find your families. Wherever your family is, that's your home. And Allah give you joy where you are. Subhanallah. Allah give you happiness. Allah give you a lightness of being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put light in your hearts. Put intelligence in your minds, in our minds. Allah show us the way. Give us a light in the dark. Make our feet firm on the path of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam amongst the people who were his hem, who were his anxiousness. Ardently anxious is he over you or about your well-being. Ra'ufur Rahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described him. And we walk amongst the people that he was anxious about. Let us be good representatives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his intents and purposes in the place where Allah has put us. Not in the place where we think we should be. Not in the places where we think we want to run to. The place where we are now. Because that's where Allah has designed for us to be now. We may need to get out of this place. If it's the last thing we ever do. Right? Sister, there's a better life for me and you. Right? We may need to get out of this place. Allah get us out if we need to get out. Right? Subhanallah. But we're here now. So, let's do our best to reflect the way of the Messenger with tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Success in the affairs of our dunya without losing success in the affairs of our akhirah. Allah make our children healthy. Amen. Allah make our bones healthy. Amen. Allah make the sincere supplication of you the marrow of our ibadah. Allah give us sincerity. Allah give us a moment of contentment in our days and in our nights in which there is no space in it except for us and you, Ya Rabbana. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala illumine the grave of your Messenger, alayhi salatu wa salam, and bring him joy when we show up. Let his face light up and let him smile. To the point where we see a little bit of his teeth. The moment that we walk in and he sees us and he sees our children and our families. Ya Rab, none of this is difficult. Allah accept our prayers. Allah accept our salawat. Allah accept our efforts. Allah accept us with all of our flaws. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stitch us up and bring us together. Gather us on you. Give us consciousness of you and conscientiousness of the people that we share our world with. Make us someone who Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam can be proud of. Ya Rabbi. And give us that joy and give us that happiness and give us smiles and give us relief in our hearts in this life and the next. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.